Good morning and welcome again to Word of Faith Fellowship radio program. This is Mark. I'm here with my great friend Bill, and we are so glad to be with you today to share with you God's Word. God has been changing our lives, and we want to share with you what God is doing. And today, Bill has a very, very powerful message. I believe it's going to change your life, and it's on hearing the voice of God. And you're going to hear from Bill about in his own life where God spoke to him and he listened to the voice of God and his life was transformed. And we're going to see in the scriptures that God is speaking to us every single day. God is actually speaking to you. As a matter of fact, he's wanting to speak to you right now, and he's wanting to direct you and lead you and answer all your questions and show you what to do every single moment of your day today. And what a great way to live. We don't have to go through today and just figure it all out, because God wants to speak to you and I and tell us what to do today. So we're going to dive right in about the voice of God and how important it is to hear his voice. So Bill, go ahead.
Thank you, Mark. And yes, it is very, very important to be able to hear the voice of God and obey. Because God's voice is who he is.
That's right.
It's designed to protect us. It's designed to lead us. It's designed to guide us. It's designed to keep us out of trouble. It's designed to chastise us, correct us. Whatever we need, God's voice is available for us every day.
Yes.
And so in the Bible here, in Exodus chapter 15, verse 26, God is saying here, if you will diligently indicates that there's got to be effort involved here. If you will diligently listen and pay attention to the voice of the Lord your God and do what is right in his sight and listen to his commandments and keep foremost in your thoughts and actively obey all his precepts and statutes, then I will not put on you any of the diseases which I have put upon the Egyptians, for I am the Lord who heals you. His voice will keep you from judgment. His voice is going to keep you from sin. His voice is going to keep you out of trouble. It's very, very important that we learn to hear and understand and know God's voice so we can develop a relationship with him. He wants to have a relationship with us. He speaks to us. He wants to help us. He Yes. loves us. In Exodus Yes. chapter 19, Yes. verse 5 and 6, it says, "Now therefore, if you will in fact obey my voice and keep my covenant, then you shall be my own special possession," special possession. God said, if you will listen to his voice, heed what he said, you will be his own special possession. I want that for my life.
Yes.
Don't you?
Yes.
"And treasure from among all peoples of the world, for all the earth is mine, and you shall be to me a kingdom of priests and a holy nation set apart for my purpose." There it is right there.
Yes.
God has called us to be set apart, not for our purposes, not for what we want to do day after day after day after day.
Right.
But it's for God's own special purpose. That's what he's called us.
Yes.
Now, in Deuteronomy chapter 28, verses 1 and 2, it says, "Now it shall be, if you diligently listen to and obey the voice of the Lord your God, being careful to do all his commandments, which I am commanding you today, the Lord your God will set you high above all the nations of the earth." That tells me we can live a totally victorious life over the devil. Yes. If we will seek God with our whole heart and obey what he's telling
That's
us
right.
to do.
Yes.
Nothing can stop us.
Right.
"All these blessings will come upon you and overtake you if you pay attention to the voice of the Lord your God." Blessings. God has nothing but blessings in store for us. So if we seek, inquire, listen to what he says, and obey what he tells us to do, we are going to partake of the blessings of God.
Yes. You know, Bill, and as we're going through these scriptures, going through Exodus, you've read Exodus, you've read Deuteronomy, I'm seeing the same language from God, the same requirement: diligently listen and pay attention. And that word diligently is something that we really should ask God to work in our hearts, because, you know, we go through our day, Bill, and yes. there's so many things that we do through the day. We're really faced with decisions all throughout the day. I know your job, working, you handle dispatching trucks and overseeing truckloads, and you're constantly communicating with truck drivers, and you're orchestrating logistics, and you're making decisions all throughout your day of how to get loads here and there, and I'm doing the same thing with my job. And so we have all these things that we're faced every day, and all the whole day, God is actually wanting to speak to us and tell us, Bill, this is how you do this,
yes.
You know, load, or, and Mark, this is how you handle your case, in the practice of law. And so, but we have to diligently listen, because if we're going to go through our day and just plow through it and just do what we think we should do, you know, we've done it before, and this is how, you know, the concept of we know what to do, so do it, you totally cut off God.
Yes, you do.
And so I'm hearing in every verse that God was saying, and of course, this is the Old Testament. This is God's people, and I know we're going to go through these, and we're going to see that that hasn't changed through the New Testament. It's even more alive, but diligently listen is something that, Bill, we've got to do through the day, purpose in our heart. God, we've got to listen to your voice. You have to fight through all of the old patterns of just going and plowing through your day.
Yes, you do. Now, can anyone hear the voice of God? Yes, you can. And the Bible tells us that.
Mm-hmm.
If you look at Psalms 40, verse 6, it says, "Sacrifice and meal offering you do not desire, nor do you delight in them. You have opened my ears and given me the capacity to hear and obey your word." God is saying here that every man has the capacity to hear and obey. Everybody can hear, but you have a choice as to whether or not you want to obey. And there have been some situations in my life where God had spoken to me and I obeyed, and it saved me, and it led me on the right track. Mm-hmm. It kept me on course in my life.
Right.
And sometimes God has had to speak to me very strongly, but it kept me and led me on the right course.
Yes.
I made it through.
Right.
All right. Now, anybody can hear the voice of God, but God wants us to have a relationship with him.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? I was thinking about the testimony that stands before me every day about my dog. When we adopted this dog and took him in, at that particular point in time, I wasn't looking for a dog. I didn't have any idea. We weren't going to have a dog. But this dog showed up in the neighborhood, and my son got attached to this dog. So I came out one day, and my son had a leash and a collar on this dog, and he was walking the dog all around the yard. He got attached to this dog. So I said, okay. So we had a family meeting, and we all decided we would take care of this dog.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so I took the dog to the vet. So when the vet examined the dog was full of all kinds of different worms.
Mm.
The dog had heartworms.
Right.
And the treatment for heartworms was very expensive back then. I think it was over $500. Mm. And back then, $500 to me would have been like $500,000.
Mm.
We were having some struggles financially. The market in the construction industry was way down. I was working construction back at that time.
Right.
I didn't know what we were going to do with this situation. The devil presented a situation, and I wasn't sure what we were going to do, but God had an answer. He had a way out. He always has a way out when you hear his voice and choose to obey.
Right.
So we had a way out. So anyway, I guess about a year went on, and this is, I was walking the dog one day, and I heard inside of me what seemed to be an audible voice, like a man speaking, like I would have a conversation with you.
Right.
And the Spirit of God said to me, "You've got to get this dog taken care of." Well, I didn't know what that meant totally. So I received that word, and I began seeking God. So we were in one of our seminars. It was a November seminar, and the next day would have been, it was a Wednesday night, and the next day would have been the Thanksgiving day where we had fellowship with our families.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? And so the dog was laying down in the chair. It was in the living room. And I started praying, and I started crying out to God for this dog. And I said, "God, please heal this dog. Please heal this dog." And I was weeping, and I was crying, and I was travailing, and the Spirit of God was moving on me. And then it lifted, and I had peace in my heart. So the very next day, we had some good friends of ours come over. And I had not talked to this person about the condition of my dog one time. She says to me, "Bill, we got to get your dog taken care of. I want you to take this dog to the vet, and I'm going to pay for it." Now, this was over a $500 veterinarian bill.
Yes.
God said, yes, do it. So if God says to do something, you better do it.
Yes.
And he walked me through it. And it wasn't an easy thing, really, to walk through. It was hard on my soul watching this dog go through this.
Right.
Because they do say when they undergo some of these treatments that they incur symptoms. And he ran all the symptoms. He had a fever. He lost weight. He lost his appetite. First couple of days seemed great. And then all of a sudden, it hit him pretty hard.
Right.
And he was lethargic. And I was really having to stand because the devil come at you in situations like this. And I was having to stand. No, God said, take this dog to the vet. So time went on. He got into about the third week of his treatment. And usually it takes 6 weeks to come out of that. Mm-hmm. He got into the third week of his treatment. And he wasn't eating. And I was very concerned about him. And I went out to the kitchen. And I asked God what to do. And I sat there and said, "Jesus, what do I do? What do I do?" And he said, "Go to," it was about 2 o'clock in the morning. Now, Walmart was open longer back then. Mm-hmm. He said, "Go to Walmart, and I want you to go get a can of dog food." I said, "Okay." So I went to Walmart. I got a can of dog food. When I came back home, I got the can of dog food. I opened it up, got a spoon, and the dog came out into the kitchen. And I started taking that spoon and feeding that dog out of that spoon. And the power of that thing broke. And then he started getting better ever since then. His appetite came back. He started eating. He started getting stronger. And by the end of it, it's been 11 years. He's as healthy as you can be.
Right.
God took care of that animal.
Right.
And he taught me about himself in that situation.
Yes. Hearing the voice of God.
Hearing the voice of God.
And God cares about every little detail. And he cares about our animals. He cares about all aspects of our life. And I didn't know you were going to share that about your dog, Bill, but you know, you reminded me about my dog, Lucy, because I had a similar experience about hearing the voice of God. We had one dog that died actually, and so we were left with one dog, and my thinking was we were done having two dogs because dogs take a lot of time, and I'm a pretty busy guy. And you know, and then all of a sudden my wife ends up having somebody who basically wanted to give away a dog that was 6 years old, a little Morkie, cute white dog. And so one day my wife calls me and is holding this little white thing, and it's at our house. And so, you know, Bill, right then, what I didn't realize was that God wanted us to have another dog in spite of me. In spite of my thinking of time and, you know, I don't have time for another dog. But at first I really just rejected the idea of another dog. My wife was, "Here's this dog," you know. And, you know, Bill, I actually had to really just ask God to forgive me, because when I settled down and I actually asked God, "Is this our dog? You know, are we supposed to have this?" I heard God tell me that this was our dog. And my thinking was not to have two dogs anymore. And, you know, God's voice came to me and said, "This is your dog." And Bill, I will tell you that it's her name's Lucy. She's basically about a 6-pound Morkie, a white, cutest dog I've ever seen. And Bill, I will tell you that I've never been really attached to dogs. And this is like the first dog in my life that this thing won't leave me. It goes everywhere I go. It sits out my side. And like if I sit down, it thing curls up next to me, and it's like God's telling me every single day that dog gets right next to me. It looks up at me that, "See, Mark, you've got to hear my voice." And see, God knows what's better. He knows what we need more than we know. And God knew that Mark Morris needed that Morkie. I have never been attached to dogs in my life, and this is the first dog I actually like really close to. But you know, God's voice came to me, Bill, like it did you, and God said, "This is your dog." And God came to you about that this is your dog and then how you're going to take care of it. But the voice of God in every single aspect of our life will keep us in his path and keep us in his blessings.
Yeah, now I want to go back a few years because there was one of, actually, God has spoken to me this strongly where it comes like an audible voice on the inside of me. Now, God speaks in many different ways, but in these particular situations, it came as an audible voice because God needed to get my attention. Mm-hmm. I wasn't even thinking along certain lines.
Right.
But when God's voice, it's like it boomed on the inside of me, and there was no mistake who was talking to me. Hmm. No mistake whatsoever. Yeah. When I was in the Navy, on board the USS Wabash, this was back during the Iranian hostage crisis. Ayatollah Khomeini had taken American hostages. And we happened to be overseas on a Pacific cruise at that point in time. And I think it was end of November. We would have been home by the end of December. And the captain got on the loudspeaker and said, we are going to go to the Indian Ocean. So we went to the Indian Ocean. So I was on the Indian Ocean for 73 straight days without being on land. And God really started to deal with my heart back then. I was running from the call of God. I was in major sin. I was not in good shape. And I knew what I was doing was wrong. I knew I was running from the call of God. But God had his way. And I was standing before those boiler gauges one night, and it was shortly after midnight. It was rather quiet down in the engineering spaces. I worked in the boiler room, and it was quiet. And now you got to understand, at that point in time in history, Russia was backing Iran. So it wasn't just Iran we were dealing with. It was Russia that we were dealing with. And they had ships in the area. You would see our aircraft carrier launch jets, and they would flank the Russian bombers, and you would see all this going on.
Right.
They had Russian destroyers that were out in the middle of the ocean. They got so close to our ship, you could throw a rock and hit them. Yeah. All this began to work on me, and I began to think about a lot of things. So I was down in that boiler room that night, and I remember the Spirit of God said to me, Bill, if you go to war and you die, where will you end up? Yeah. And I thought long and hard about that. The Spirit of God spoke to me. He had to get my attention, and he did. And then I obeyed, and I started going to Bible studies, and I started moving toward God. But the one thing I want to stress here is the divine providence of God. It doesn't matter what kind of a pit you're in. It doesn't matter what kind of circumstances you're facing. It doesn't matter what the devil is lying to you, what kind of torment is coming at you. It doesn't matter where you're at in life. God knows who you are, where you are. The hairs of your head are numbered, and he wants to reach out and speak to you and help you to attain victory in your life.
Right.
He wants a relationship with you.
Yes.
But you've got to press in and seek the voice of God for your life. He will direct you.
That's good.
He has never failed me. Not one time in my life has God ever failed me. Every single time, even when I've got to a hard place in my life and I turned my heart to God, the answer always came. It may not have always been immediately, maybe in a few days, a few weeks, but the answer always came.
Right.
I like hearing the voice of God. I love hearing the voice of God. That's what I live for. I live to hear his voice. I live to feel his presence. And when I can't hear his voice, I'm concerned. Then I'm checking out, Bill, what's going on? Where have you cut off God today?
Right.
You're not hearing his voice. You don't feel his presence. And every time I seek and inquire of God, he showed me where I got off course.
Yes.
He corrects that, sets me back on my feet, gets me walking the straight and narrow again. I feel his presence and hear his voice.
Right.
That's a loving God we serve.
Yes.
He wants us to make it in our lives.
Very good. That's right. You know, you started off with the Exodus 15 about listen and pay attention to the voice of the Lord and listen to his commandments. And that's what you're talking about is we go through our day, Bill, and we really cannot expect to hear God's voice if we're just doing what we want to do. If you're going through your day and you have basically totally cut off God and you think you know what to do and you have a course and you just, I'm going to do this today and I'm not going to even think about asking God, then you are, we're separated from God when we decide to set our own course each day. And Bill, what you're saying is You want to hear the voice of God through the day and listen to his presence. And you're aware, if you're cut off from God, what's going on? And that really should be all our hearts is God, if I can't feel your presence and I'm not hearing your voice, somewhere I'm separated from you. God, show me where I've cut you off. And then what we do is we get our heart right, and then we can hear his voice.
Always.
That's right.
Never fails. And my job, you know, you've mentioned my job and the occupation that I do at night. I do this at night on second shift from about 3:30 to midnight. Mm-hmm. So basically the day shift goes home. So everything the day shift is set on course.
Right.
It's my job to be a watchman on the wall and make sure it all happens smoothly. So I cannot do my job without hearing God's voice. I mean, it can be very stressful at times.
Right.
But God always speaks. I can't tell you the number of times something would come up that some kind of responsibility I would need to take care of. Mm-hmm. And then a phone call would come in, and then a rash of phone calls would come in, and then I would totally forget about it. And then all of a sudden, the Spirit of God said, don't forget this.
Right.
And bring it to my remembrance. And I would do it and take care of it, and it would save a situation from happening.
Right. Now, you are, Bill, what do you do, just so people can see how it works, you know, hearing the voice of God? Are you in logistics with truckloads being picked up? Or
yes. In other words, at night, I have to kind of manage the fleet. I've got to keep the ship afloat, so to speak.
So meaning trucks are going to end up in
certain places? In other words, we have reefer loads. These reefers are running at specific temperatures with certain products on them.
Mm-hmm.
I have to make sure that those reefers are maintained at the proper temperature and that they're running correctly. Nothing's breaking down. I have to make sure that appointment times are going to be met. You know, the drivers make their pickup times and their delivery times. And you have to manage all this. And then not to mention, there's phone calls that come in with personal issues.
Right.
Apart from logistics that sometimes you have to get involved in.
Right, right.
So it's a lot of responsibility.
Yes.
And I can't do it without God's help.
Right, right.
I depend on God quite a bit.
Yes.
Totally, that's really.
That's good. That's good.
So, okay, let's see. So really, I believe, as I stated before, to know God's voice is to know him. Mm-hmm. Jesus said something about that. He said that my sheep know my voice.
Mm-hmm.
He said who enter in John 10:1, it says, he who enters by the door is the shepherd of the sheep. He's the protector and the provider. The doorkeeper opens the gate for this man, and the sheep hear his voice. They not only hear his voice, but they pay attention to it. And knowing that they listen, he calls his own sheep by name and leads them out to pasture. There you go. It doesn't matter what kind of a circumstance you're in. God has a voice that wants to speak to you and lead you out of whatever situation you're in.
That's good.
I mean, what more is there to life?
Yes. To his pasture, Bill.
That's
his,
right.
His place of peace and safety in the midst of you dealing with all these truckloads and all these trucks getting where they need to get to. God says if you listen to his voice, he'll lead you into this pasture of his where you're in the peace of God in the midst of handling all of the stuff that you have to do every single day.
Yes, he will. And I do have peace for the most part. Sometimes, if I get stressed sometimes and cut off God, then I don't have peace. But God convicts me every time I do that. He said, Bill, I need to settle down, give the peace, listen to my voice. I'm going to show you what to do in this situation.
Right.
And he does it every time without fail. I love serving God.
Yes.
So he proceeds to say is, they know his voice and they recognize his call, and they will never, never follow a stranger. People that are really sold out to Jesus and have a relationship with him, they know his voice. When God speaks, they know that. They can recognize this is Jesus.
Right.
If I was in a room full of people, and all this bustling was going on, and all this talking, and all of a sudden my wife walked into the room and said, Bill, I would know who's calling me. Why? Right. Well, why is that? I know her voice because I have a relationship with her.
Right.
Right?
Yes.
Jesus' sheep know his voice.
Uh-huh.
And the voice of a stranger, they will not follow.
That's good.
Okay. Now, there are consequences to not obeying the voice of God. I had a situation in my own life. This was a third time that God spoke to me very strongly. I was working construction work. And I was working on something in a skylight up over the top of a bathtub. And I had propped a ladder up there, and I was standing on the ladder. And the Spirit of God spoke to me and said very strongly, just like he did when he spoke to me about my dog, when he spoke to me when I was in the belly of that ship, he spoke to me and he said, "You don't have the right ladder for this job." I mean, it came very strongly. And I reasoned it away. I stepped back for a minute. I did not press in. I was under the pressure of having to get something done. I did not press in to see what else God had to say about this. And I just stabilized the ladder, and I proceeded to climb back up on the ladder. Now remember, God said, "You do not have the right ladder for this job." Mm-hmm. The next thing I know, I feel the ladder shift. All of a sudden, I come down, my leg goes through the rung of the ladder, all my body weight landed on my left heel. I fractured my heel, cracked it like an egg, and I had four or five fractures across my ankle. And the pain was excruciatingly intense. And I'm laying on that floor, and I knew I did something very serious to my body. And all I could do was repent.
Yeah.
But here's the thing. That stands before me every day. Right. That's before me every day.
Right.
You cannot disobey God's voice when he's telling you to do something.
Mm-hmm.
You've got to obey. Right. He's only got good things for you. I didn't have to go through all that I went through. I mean, it took me 2 years to recover from that. Right. And still, even standing on a ladder, sometimes mm-hmm. it's hard, you know.
Right.
But it always comes back to my remembrance. I did not obey the voice of God that day. It's kind of like David. Kings go out to battle.
Right.
He decided not to go out to battle, and it cost him a lot.
Right, right. That's when he sinned with Bathsheba. Everybody else was out to battle. He stayed behind, and he fell into sin.
And he fell into sin.
Right.
Okay? I did not obey God, and it cost me.
Yes.
But God's been working with me, and there are things I can do that God still helps me do.
Right.
And I can get beyond all that.
Right.
So there has been restoration in my life.
Yes.
So, how are we to live our lives? John 5:30. I can do nothing on my own initiative or authority. Just as I hear, I judge, and my judgment is just, fair, righteous, unbiased, because I do not seek my own will, but only the will of him who sent me. God has a plan. God has a purpose. We are put here on this earth to fulfill his purpose. In fulfilling his purpose, he puts a call on our life. We have a job to do. You have a job to do. I have a job to do. We all, as a collective body of believers, have a job to do to fulfill God's plan and purpose
right.
in life.
Yes.
That's why we're here.
Yes. And Bill, you know, summarizing everything that we've shared today, Bill, John 5:30, one of the things that Jesus said of himself is he said that I can do nothing of my own self, and I don't seek my own will. I just seek the will of the Father. And, you know, as we go through our day, if we really want to hear the voice of God, we have to say that. We have to have a heart that says, I don't want to do my own will. I only want to do the will of the Father. And if you want to hear the voice of God, and as Bill said, hearing the voice of God is the most exciting thing. Hearing the voice of God is the thing that you and I should live for, the thing that we should endeavor and diligently strive for every single day, to hear his voice. And if you want to hear the voice of God and you want to live a life that is in the presence of God and exciting and full of the wonderful plan that God has for you, then you and I have to do what Jesus did when he was here in the form of a man. And he said, I don't seek my own will. I seek the will of the Father. And that's how we're going to hear the voice of God. Every single day, God, not my will. I don't want my will today. I don't want to do what I think I need to do, but I want to do your will. And then God can speak and we can hear his voice. So we're out of time, but thank you again for listening. And we are on this radio program Mondays, Wednesdays, and Fridays, 8:30 to 9. All of our radio programs are videoed. They're on our website, www.wordoffaithfellowship.org. Thank you so much.